All right, guys, welcome back to our second of the first round matches in the Book It tournament. The first match was a barn burner between Strack and Scott McLeod. If you haven't seen that one, go and check it out, because I will be discussing the outcome of that match very openly as I break down the bracket here. So make sure you go and check that one out. Also go and check out everything else that's on ESSR, Spotify, iTunes, wherever you get your podcast. Go and check out ESSR Central. It's a flagship show on Thursdays where we run down the week that was in wrestling, and the ESSR feature show where we go through a variety of topics, both historical and contemporary, on a Tuesday for you there. A lot of great shows on there. Saturday Draft Live, for one of our competitors, is one of the hosts of that show. East Meets West, all these good things. On this YouTube channel, you can check out Quiz Showdown. You can also check out The Conspiracy Theory, starring yours truly. But today, we are going to be doing the second of our first round matches in the Book It tournament. So let's get the competitors on right now. Introducing first, he is one of the brains behind the Pod 67 podcast. He is, at the time of recording, a former ESSR champion. Again, a former ESSR champion. He is the man who can always be relied upon. It is the podcast king himself, Ryan Gallacher. Ryan, welcome to you, son. You are a man all around the podcast world at the minute. You are a journeyman, but you're here. You're here at the Book It tournament. How are you feeling about it today?
I'm feeling good, man. I watched the previous Book It show. I'm not going to lie, man, that bar was set quite high, wasn't it?
Mate, like, did you see me? I was like, fuck. I don't know, like, I guess could go either way. But, like, you've been known, Ryan, I think it's not unfair to say you have a reputation for, you're a man with a schedule. You know, sometimes you can come in super prepared, and sometimes you like to take the conversation off topic. It was you and Ryan Wilson singing, and anyway, back to the wrestling. Do you think it's a clash of styles between you and your opponent today? Is that safe to say?
I think it's going to come down to the brains behind it, whether I can win this and find a way to somehow overcome my opponent.
Yeah,
I'll give him his due. I think he's going to be a strong challenger here.
I think so, and let's get him here. Introducing second, he is one of the OGs of ESSR. He is one of the hosts of Saturday Draft Live at time of recording. He is a seven-time ESSR champion. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome the stat man himself, David Campbell. It's good to have you here. The hat is well and truly firmly on the head, as per usual, ready to go. You're a man, you've competed in everything the ESSR has: quizzes, sweeps, debating chambers, you name it. How are you feeling about this new challenge today?
Not going to lie, GOAT, I am actually got butterflies in my stomach. You know, a new challenge has presented itself, but I take it the same way I take every other challenge. I try and come in as best prepared as I can, and I can only applaud the effort I put in. And I look forward to see what Ryan has up against me.
And there is history here. Like, let's not forget, you two have battled in the debating chamber. Ross McLeod called it out in the chat. Dave, some people have said that Ryan got the better of you in that exchange. Is there any beef here from that exchange?
No, none. I wouldn't say so. It's I'll admit my debating chamber performance could have been a little bit better, but then again, I'm not used to debating concept. My strength mainly lies in mainly quizzes and just knowing random stuff off the top of my head. But I've come in with a plan this time, and I think I'm going to be able to stand my ground a lot better.
Ryan, thinking back to that debating chamber, is there something in there that you're like, I know how to push Dave's buttons, I know how to maybe tear apart his card a wee bit here? Are you playing on that?
No, absolutely not. No, taking nothing from that, because it's a completely different challenge. I will gladly say in this one today, I am the underdog. I'm hoping that I can somehow win my career. Like I say, can I bring a bit of pride back to myself, because I've not given myself the best outlet for it, but we'll see what happens.
We'll see how it goes. So the theme for today is NXT Takeover Reunion. We're going back with it. It's going to be former stars, it's going to be current stars of NXT, and it's a big reunion. The specifications for the guys here, they'll be booking, like I said, Takeover Reunion. You can use any competitor who's ever competed on NXT Takeover, but they must have an NXT title match, an NXT women's title match, an NXT tag title match, and an NXT North American title match. As always, they can use up to 3 special stipulation matches. Dave, just sum it up for us. What is special about NXT as a brand?
NXT as a brand is a brand that likes to take an approach in which less is more. And sometimes simplicity is all you need to deliver a good card. And I think that's what I've got going ahead. I've got a very good mix of matches, a good mix of alumni and current roster members, and a couple other surprises that you might not expect. And I think those are the ingredients for a successful NXT TakeOver.
A wee preview of what's to come from there, Dave. Ryan, what's some of your favourite NXT TakeOver moments from the past?
Oh, best moments. I think one of my favourite NXT moments, and it's a recurring moment, I think, happened in NXT, was when you had the great tag teams going through the AOP, DIY. All the matches that these guys put on at TakeOvers over the years have been unbelievable. So I couldn't actually pick one specific moment because they've all been class. And that sounds like a pure cliche thing to say when you don't know what you're talking about. Actually, genuinely, I can think of them all. I can think every match has been between all these guys, especially when DIY were winning the titles, when they were losing the titles, when they broke up. You know, probably if I was to pick a moment when they broke up would be the main one, but I would even struggle to put that above anything else that's happened to the NXT TakeOvers, mate.
And without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to book it. Let's do it. We're going to get it done. Guys, I have the numbers 1 and 2 in front of me. They're randomly corresponding to who's going to go first or second. So, Dave, I'll come to you. Please pick either number 1 or number 2.
1.
Dave, you're going first. So I'm going to mute my mic. Ryan is going to mute his. You will have 10 minutes to make your argument. If you go over, you will be penalised for it. Please bear in mind, up to 7 matches on the card, 5 mm-hmm. segments, all right? 3 of your matches can be special stipulation, and I need the times for each match read out for us here. Are you ready to go? Any more questions, Dave?
No, I'm ready.
All right, okay, Dave, your time starts now.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, David Haughney presents to you NXT TakeOver Reunion. Now, before I get into the booking of this card, I want to make a few assumptions ahead of time. So, firstly, the current champions will be as at time of recording, and Finn Balor will be medically cleared to compete by this point. Any other superstars on the injury list or signed with any big promotion are ineligible to appear. The theme for this show, this reunion show, is going to be the current NXT roster versus NXT alumni, and they will all have competed on past takeovers. Now, one other thing I would like to point out is COVID-19 will still be an issue for this show. So the restrictions that are currently in place will also be applied to this show. So the venue for NXT TakeOver Reunion, we have the Capitol Wrestling Center, or as formerly known as the WWE Performance Center. The ring announcer for this show will be the current announcer for Monday Night Raw, Greg Hamilton. The commentary team, we will have Wade Barrett, Beth Phoenix, and for the big first surprise of the night, making his return to NXT, the legend himself, Mauro Ranallo. Now, the audience for this match, it will be members of the NXT roster that are not actively on the card, plus a few alumni here or thereabouts that are not that have been on NXT before. So, the opening segment. As we've got to start off big, we're going to start with Triple H in the ring addressing the audience. He says, tonight won't just be looking about the future of WWE. Tonight, it will feature the coming together of the past, present, and future of NXT that continues to make it the greatest brand in sports entertainment. So without any further ado, let's the reunion commence. Match 1, and it is for the NXT Tag Team Championship, where Breezango have issued an open challenge. They will enter out first. They might entertain the crowd with their extravagant entrance in some way. Who answers the challenge? The Ascension. Yes, the Ascension have been re-signed by WWE in what is a shocking return to kickstart the night And everybody in the audience assumes, you know, it could be AOP, it could be American Alpha, but no. The Ascension has come back and they're coming for a second tag team title reign. And now let's not forget, they are the longest reigning NXT tag team champions in history. Now, this match clocks in at a solid 8 minutes, 45 seconds. Breezango gets some offense in, but the Ascension dominates from start to finish. Your winners and new NXT tag team champions, the Ascension. So what a way to kick off the night. Now, second segment, we will cut to backstage where we'll get a message from the current SmackDown Tag Team Champions, the Street Profits, and also a little bit of an interaction with former NXT Tag Team Champions, American Alpha, because Shorty G is currently a member of the SmackDown roster and Jason Jordan is a producer. So have two NXT alumni teams interacting and cutting a message for the audience. Now, match two is for the NXT North American Championship, and it will be a gauntlet eliminator match. Damian Priest has basically said he will take on anyone to cement himself as a top competitor. William Regal is still hot on the idea of a gauntlet eliminator, so he sets up another one with current roster and alumni. And in this match, Wade Barrett will be subbed off commentary and be replaced by another alumni member, Samoa Joe. So in this match, we will have Damian Priest starting off. First opponent from the alumni section, King Corbin. Third, from the current roster, Roderick Strong. Number four, from the alumni, Apollo Crews. Number five, from the current roster, Ricochet. Oh, no, sorry, Velveteen Dream. And lastly, from the alumni, Ricochet. So, a great mix of former champions, alumni, and current stars. And so, in this match, Priest goes the distance, clocking in 32 minutes, 47 seconds, but eliminates Ricochet last. So Ricochet looks on as Damian Priest poses with the championship, somewhat of a look of respect, but also a little bit of disdain, which teases a possible return for NXT. Match three. This is a feud based on family and moral values. It will be the Gargano way versus Fight Owens Fight. Yes, we have from the current roster, Johnny Gargano, and from the alumni section, Kevin Owens. Now, before this match, in the sort of video opening video package, we cut back to a promo where Sami Zayn, Kevin Owens' best friend, supports the Gargano way and reminds everybody what Kevin Owens did to him at TakeOver Unstoppable. Now, when these two go together, you're going to expect a very solid match, clocking in a respectable 15 minutes, 5 seconds. Now, the key moment for this is Gargano goes for the final beat on the ropes. Kevin Owens counters to a stunner, throws him to the ropes, pop-up powerbomb, 1-2-3, Kevin Owens wins. And afterwards, segment three, Sami Zayn tries to apologize, saying that his way does work and forgives KO for what he did at TakeOver Unstoppable. But then here's the kicker. Goes for a handshake, tries a sneak attack, Owens counters it into a stunner. Boom, Kevin Owens stands tall. Now in NXT, we do like to do some crowd shots. So as we build to our next match, we cut to a crowd shot. Sitting in the audience is Paige and SmackDown Women's Champion Bayley. And that brings us nicely into the NXT Women's Championship match. The current champion, Io Shirai, going up against Asuka. Now, this is going to be hands down match of the night based on showcase of abilities, history, chemistry, and storytelling. Io wants to face the best. She calls out Asuka. And bear in mind, Asuka's never officially lost the NXT Women's Championship, which sparks a match between these two. Winner after a hard-fought match of 23 minutes and 36 seconds, Io Shirai. She comes out looking like a megastar. They both embrace after a hard-fought match. And Asuka finally gets a proper send-off from NXT, like losing, going out on her back, rather than just relinquishing the championship. Segment four, it is a message from three of the four horsewomen. We have Sasha Banks, Charlotte Flair, and Becky Lynch all sending best wishes to the current roster and looking ahead to the future, because you can't have a reunion without all four horsewomen making an appearance. And speaking of women's matches, surprise, surprise, we're getting another championship match. And this one is going to feature two of the most dominant women as part of the alumni roster. So we have Shayna Baszler and Nia Jax defending the WWE Women's Tag Team Championship. Yes, they can be defended on NXT. Don't at me on this. And their challengers from the current roster will be Dakota Kai and Raquel Gonzalez. So in the lead up to this, Shayna claims she is the most dominant woman in NXT, not Io Shirai, not Asuka, not anyone else. And as in turn, this encourages some trading jibes with Nia, given that they've got that whole Team Hell No dynamic going on. Meanwhile, Dakota says that her and Raquel are the true tag team of NXT and that they support each other unlike their opponents and that they deserve to be champions. Now, obviously, there's been a lot of emotion coming off from the Io Asuka match. So, sort of cool things down a little bit. This match will clock in at a respectable 10 minutes, 22 seconds. Now, Shayna and Nia will have their work cut out for them because they've got a new powerhouse with Raquel Gonzalez at the mix. So, they put up a good effort, but your winners and still women's tag team champions, Shayna Baszler and Nia Jax. Now, before we get to the final match, we will cut to a crowd shot because in attendance is the WWE champion and former NXT champion, Drew McIntyre. And this leads us very nicely into what is our main event. And it will be an NXT championship ladder match. Three members from the current roster, three members from the alumni section, all former NXT champions, and all these competitors have history with at least one other competitor. And what we want is a very unpredictable match with a mix of varying styles. You know, it could be powerhouses, high flyers, technical ability. And our lineup is the current champion, Finn Balor, from the current roster, Tommaso Ciampa, and Adam Cole. From the alumni section, we have Keith Lee, Aleister Black, and Shinsuke Nakamura. Now, in the build-up to this, there were qualifies for the alumni members. We have Keith Lee getting a victory over Robert Roode to qualify. We have Aleister Black getting a victory over Andrade to qualify. And Shinsuke Nakamura defeats his own tag team partner, Cesaro, to qualify. Now, anything can happen with a ladder match. And I think this one will be on par with TakeOver New Orleans for the North American Championship. So much back and forth action. You know, people getting put through ladders, some high-flying spots from the likes of Aleister Black and Adam Cole. Keith Lee might put somebody through a ladder, and it's going to be an absolute carnage fest of a match. Clocking in at 25 minutes, 13 seconds, your winner of this match, and still NXT champion, Finn Balor. He poses the top of the ladder with the championship in an audience of current roster and alumni cheering on. Now, for the final section, as he poses, the camera cuts to the podium at the top of the stage, where there is an hourglass. Tick-tock. Camera fades out. There is NXT TakeOver Reunion.
Very, very good. Very good, Dave. Very good. Very much enjoyed being taken on that ride there. Without further ado, we're going to mute our mics. 10 minutes for Ryan Gallacher. Start now.
Thank you very much, Mr. Campbell. Dave, I just want to say that was a strong card there, mate. I think you should be booking NXT shows in future. A lot of that I would love to see, mate. But I did start off by saying that, you know, I've maybe misjudged this one a little bit, this show. But after listening to Dave, I'm probably not far off, right? So I'm going to start this show quite similar to Dave's with Triple H. He's in the ring announcing that this is going to be the past versus the present of NXT. So these people are going to be involved with NXT somehow. They're going to be on kind of takeovers in the past, having certain matches. But he comes out and he kind of cuts a bit of a heel promo. You know, Triple H has always been very promoting NXT. We are this, we are that. But he takes a bit of a different turn with this one. He announces that NXT is his baby. This is his thing. He runs NXT. You know, he is the life and soul of the brand. And he said that this would never happen. NXT would never happen without him. Cue the music. Out comes. You know, he might not have wrestled on takeovers before, but he comes in for the segment. He is confronted by none other than Dustin Rhodes. Confronts Triple H at the start of this show. He comes out and says that nothing that's happened in NXT would happen without the great Dusty Rhodes. Okay, so he comes out. They have a bit of an argument in terms of this, bit of a scuffle. Triple H eventually leaves the ring, squirms away. Dustin Rhodes is left standing in the ring. And I should also point out, I'm similar to Dave, this is going to be happening in kind of current times. It's COVID times. The crowd is made up of, you know, NXT stars just now. So that's what your crowd's going to be made up of. But they're all, the majority of them, they wouldn't be where they are at this point in their career without Dusty Rhodes as well. So they're totally on board with this. They take the side of Dustin. they start celebrating Dusty, everybody starts chanting Dusty. It's like a feel-good moment. His face comes up on the screen, have a wee cry, and then it fades. So it fades away at that point, and then you get your music to start the show, you get your intro. Dave, I've actually got the same kind of lineup in terms of announcer and ring announcer and commentators for this one. I also have Greg Hamilton, because for me, anybody who's been on NXT before doesn't come close to him. Just now, I think what he's doing on the main rosters as well just now is absolutely outstanding. He's the guy that I thought of for us the second that it came out. My announcers are going to be a little bit like yours. I'm going to have Morrow. He's going to be back for this one, but he's going to be flanked by Samoa Joe, who for me is the guy who can come in. He's been on NXT before, on Takeovers before, but he's actually doing some outstanding work on commentary just now. I think he's one of the best going in the minute. Your commentator for me on a show like this has to be somebody who knows what he's talking about, who's been there and done it. If you've add him in alongside Morrow, who's one of the greatest commentators there's ever been, sold, right? So the difference is, for me, I don't change my names team. Like you kind of swapped a couple through the show. That doesn't happen here. I've got these two going from the very start to the very end. So they announced the first match. So a little bit of a build for this one. My opening match is going to be for the NXT Women's title, right? This is going to set the trend for how this show is going to go. It's going to be Io Shirai is going to be the current champion, and she's going to be up against Paige in this one. So let me explain why I think Paige is going to be in this, because the build-up to this show has been a little bit different. Obviously, we can't fantasy book the run-up to it, but Paige has been quite instrumental in this. She returned to NXT a few weeks beforehand. She's been challenging Io Shirai. She's telling her that, similar to Triple H, there's a bit of a theme going on here of somebody thinking that they are the reason for the NXT. Paige, you know, like her or lump her, she is one of the best women that's ever been in NXT, one of the best champions as well. She comes back. She has a bit of a kind of beef with Io Shirai. They have this match. I tell you, it is relatively quick, this match. Io Shirai deals with Paige very, very quickly, cements herself as one of the best, if not the best, competitors that's ever been in NXT. The match itself is only around about 10 minutes. I've not been as specific as Dave on my timings here. It's around about 10 minutes time. Like I say, Paige was the driving force behind this. Io Shirai comes in and absolutely bosses her. Paige gets a little bit of an offense in, but it's a bit of a squash match, if I'm honest with you. You know, it's setting the tone, it's setting, you know, you are the past, this is the present and the future of NXT. For me, that's where it starts. I haven't done a lot of backstage segments in this, because I'm kind of basing this on kind of the way NXT is just now. When you get a takeover just now, there's not a lot happening backstage. You know, there's not a lot kind of that you need to build. You know, NXT takeovers for me, the build happens before it, and your takeover show is just literally the matches, you know, solid matches. I've changed it a little bit for this one. We've got six matches on this card, which is different to the usual five the NXT normally have. But I had to obviously kind of fit certain things in. So there's not a lot happening backstage, but what you do get is a kind of build for championship matches, which you've seen most recently with Finn Balor and Kyle O'Reilly when they were having their match, their most recent takeover. You get a bit of build backstage with a kind of dramatic music, and you see them come down the corridor up to the, you know, kind of, well, I was going to say gorilla position, but they've never really got a gorilla position. Come along the back. That happens for every match on this, because every match's build has been massive. So before that, you've got the build up to this one. So match two, David Campbell, I don't know if I've actually given you this lineup properly, right? Because it has changed a little bit in the preparation to today, right? This one's going to be a fatal four-way tag team title match, the second one, and it's going to involve some of the best tag teams that's been past and present in NXT. We're going to have the Revival are going to be in this, Heavy Machinery are going to be in this, DIY have got back together for this, and from the Undisputed Era, Kyle O'Reilly and Bobby Fish. So it's going to be a four-way tag team title match. Sorry, for the NXT tag team titles. Solid match, as you can imagine, with these guys. You know, Revival, for me, one of the best tag teams in the world. They were probably one of the best tag teams in NXT, if not the best there's ever been. You know, Undisputed Era, you know, they speak for themselves, DIY as well. The Heavy Machinery Boys, that's a bit of a curveball for me. You know, that's a kind of throw them in to this, because I think people forget just how good Heavy Machinery can be as a tag team when, you know, we see them actually, you know, whatever's happening with Otis and Tucker just now, they've made an arse of it on the main roster. But if you go back to what you guys have done previously, like, there's no... They're up there. They're definitely up there as one of the kind of best tag teams that's been there. And I think this match, having four of these teams, the spots in it are outstanding. This one goes maybe about 25 minutes, because obviously you've got four teams, and this one, there's a lot you can kind of cram in to this match. The winner for me, Undisputed Era, pick up this. They deliver the finisher on Tucker. He's the one that has to take the pin in this one. At the end of the match, they obviously celebrate that they've won the titles. But there's a bit of a moment towards the end where all four teams are left standing in the ring. The crowd are celebrating, they're cheering for them, clapping their hands, and all four teams just have a little bit of a look to each other and go, we've just nailed that. That is a moment that we've just put on. So before they can even leave the ring, Sami Zayn's music hits. And Sami Zayn comes out, tells them all to get out of the ring. So they have a little bit of a look at each other, like, who the fuck is this guy? Who's he talking to? Right? But they're like, okay, fine, we'll leave. So they leave. Sami Zayn's like, yeah, you better run, as total heel tactics. So he gets rid of them. He cuts a bit of a promo where it's almost as if he takes on that kind of Triple H attitude for the start of the show, like I was saying, where he comes out and he says basically it's a joke that he wasn't booked on this show to begin with. He's had to turn up here. You know, he is the same as Triple H, the life and soul of NXT, one of the best, you know, kind of challengers, competitors, sorry, that's ever came from NXT. But he then also says, I get it, I do understand. He said there's nobody, past or present, on NXT that can actually go toe-to-toe with him, that he thinks, you know, that's why he's not being booked, because it'd be unfair to book him. Lights go down. Everybody's wondering what the hell's happening. A wee spotlight just comes up at the top of the ramp. Cesaro emerges to confront Sami Zayn. We know they've had their things in the past with NXT where they had all them great, probably the greatest matches that have ever happened in NXT have been between them two. They then teamed up on the main roster. You know, however that went, you know, you can say it was good, you can say it was bad. But now this has happened. They've came to this NXT reunion show, and Sami Zayn is basically confronted by Cesaro. They have a great match.
Just to let you know, Ryan, you've just passed the 10-minute mark, so you will be penalised for that.
Fine.
After, but just finish your show, okay?
No. That was the quickest 10 minutes of all time. Here's me coming unprepared as well for the show. I'll quickly run through this, because not a lot of it's kind of changes throughout the show. So Sami Zayn and Cesaro have another great match. It goes for about 15 minutes. Great match again. It's up there with one of the matches they had before. It's probably going to get thought of as one of the kind of best singles matches that there's ever been as well. Right, I'll quickly skip through this. I've got a few matches to go. Match 4 is a North American title match. It's along the kind of same lines as the one we had before for that. You know, you had guys like Lars Sullivan and all that were involved in it as well. But this one is going to have Matt Riddle, Keith Lee, Aleister Black, Nakamura, Neville as well is going to be in it. I'm going to throw Neville into this one. And somebody we've been speaking about recently, who we thought was going to be coming back but ended up not coming back, Bo Dallas, is going to be coming back for this one as well. So you need that kind of a contrast of styles in this one. Winner, I'm going to take Keith Lee in this one. He's going to build us through the competitors in that one. Keith Lee's going to take the win. Match 5, women's tag team title match. So Sasha and Bayley are the champs at this point, much to David Campbell's annoyance, because he picked them in the draft, even though we all knew they were going to split up. But they're tag team champions just now in this one, okay? They're going up against four horsewomen, Charlotte and Becky, in this one. But I said there wasn't going to be much things happening before the matches, but the camera does cut backstage, and Becky has been taken out backstage. So Charlotte's going this one alone. She's got nobody there with her. She says, I can take two of these. I can actually win these titles myself. And they say, well, no, you can't. That's not going to happen. So they start beating her down. Out comes Rhea Ripley. Your WrestleMania match, she comes out to back up Charlotte Flair. Two of them have a great match. They win the titles. They take the titles. It's almost like a bit of a, we had this match before. We had this rivalry before. Put it aside. We are the greatest of all time. Two of us from both eras. So, Dave, we're similar as well in the next bit because the camera pans to the crowd, and I also have Drew in the crowd, the current WWE champ. He's in the crowd for the main event. There's no bells and whistles in this one, boys. It's a straight-up fight. NXT title. Adam Cole is your champ. He gets to handpick his challenger for this one. He doesn't announce it before the show because he said, I'm going to save this one for the show, and it's going to shock you. And out comes the, can we now call him it? The Monday Night Messiah, Seth Rollins, comes out for a one-on-one match with Adam Cole. You know, past and present, that is past and present of NXT. You know, Adam Cole is probably the best champion there's been. Seth Rollins, you know, he was one of the first as well. So I keep saying solid match. This is going to be one of the best matches you've seen of all time. In my opinion, it goes for about 25 minutes. It's back and forward. You know, there's close calls, there's close pins. You know, it just goes on for ages. Adam Cole picks up the win in this one because I think he had to. He picks up the win. He's celebrating in the corner. He turns round. Drew has made his way from ringside into the ring to confront Adam Cole. So this, in my head, this is getting put on just between the Royal Rumble and WrestleMania. They set up a WrestleMania champion versus champion, winner takes all match at WrestleMania after this one. So that's where it's going to go, but that's the confrontation that we have in the ring to end NXT TakeOver reunion.
Wow. So fantastic shows from both. Like Dave came in, great show there, Ryan. You said super underprepared, but wow, great card that you put together. I do have, we're going to go into our discussion. I'm going to ask you to defend certain things, but there's points that I'm already sort of given each way already, Ryan. Obviously, you went over with time, so I've docked you for that. However, you got it right back with that main event, and I have to say, they got that point ahead of Dave because, Dave, I loved your main event. It's a six-man ladder match, which sounds very exciting. However, you already have a multi-man match in the show for the North American Championship. And I feel it was more to get more bodies on the show than anything else. Ryan, yours was a great one-on-one match. There's a story to be told there that built it was excellent. And that's not to say, I think your aftermatch for both of that was great. I loved the Karrion Kross tease from Dave. I thought that was perfect. And Ryan, that's a very bold story that you're telling with Drew and Cole. But you leveled it up there for me. The women's title match, I don't think it's a contest. I think Dave goes up again from that one. I like having Paige back, Ryan. I do like having Paige back. And she's doing the job to Shirai, but Dave just painted a better picture with that. That's his best show in the card, you know. And Io Shirai versus Asuka is something that all of us, I'm sure, would want to see. I'm going to give you, however, I'm going to get you back in the game for Sami Zayn versus Cesaro. It's a repeat of a classic match. You've played into that classic NXT match thing. And I've went ahead of Dave's utilization of Sami Zayn there because I feel that Sami Zayn should be on this card. It's NXT TakeOver Reunion and he's too big a part of NXT not to be competing. However, I do see what you did with that, Dave, there. All right. So he's our level, in my opinion, because of all that. However, there are a couple of key areas that I do now want to discuss. One of them is the NXT Tag Team Championship match that both of you put on. Dave, why would you put Breezango versus The Ascension ahead of Revival versus Heavy Machinery versus DIY versus Fish and O'Reilly?
I will happily explain that because if you remember at the very start of my card, I said that any competitor that's currently signed to a major promotion, whether they be that Impact or AEW or anywhere else, I have deemed to be ineligible to compete because obviously there is still a ratings war going on. And I think it would be completely contradictory to have the Revival on that show. As much as I would like to have them on, I just cannot justify having them on given they're signed with AEW. And I would also like to point out Ryan Gallacher. Have Heavy Machinery actually competed at a takeover before?
Don't know. Probably not.
I'm pretty sure that was one of the stipulations added to the.
I'm pretty sure they would have. They were in NXT for a lot. They can't have been through their whole time in NXT without being on one takeover, surely.
I think
correct on that one, and that's why it's 2 points that I had to get Dave to bring up, you know, as the competitor here, Ryan. But
and secondly, sorry, Goat, to interrupt you.
Well, thirdly,
sorry. Has Seth Rollins competed on a takeover as well? Because
he made an appearance on a takeover in a prominent segment, so I will allow it for that reason.
He came out to challenge Triple H, didn't he?
Yeah,
okay.
Right,
because it was my understanding that they had to have competed on a takeover rather than just appear.
I'm going to understand that. It's a slight shifting of it. However, as judge, I have decided to allow Rollins for that edict alone.
Very well, but I will also say this as well. We've kind of already seen Adam Cole versus Seth Rollins on Monday Night Raw.
Just to jump in there, Dave, I just wanted to clarify, NXT TakeOver New Orleans, April 7, 2018, second match on the card, Heavy Machinery versus Riddick Moss and Tino Sabatelli.
Was that on the pre-show? I think that was actually aired on NXT TV. It wasn't technically part of TakeOver.
Was there, wasn't it?
We're getting into semantics here, all right? Wow.
I'm just saying, you're sort of muddying waters a bit here.
I'm glad we had that discussion, because I do need to give, although I think Ryan's tag match does sound better because of the fact Revival are signed to AEW, and there's a couple of things you stretch the realism of, but because of that fact, I have to give a one-up to Dave there.
I would say, though, Dave, just to jump in on you there, you never told me that I couldn't pick people from other promotions. This is all fantasy booking, mate. This is total.
It's all fantasy booking, but it's an argument that Dave's brought up, and it's an argument I find convincing of as the judge. If Dave hadn't pointed it out, we might not be having this discussion.
Listen, in a perfect world, I would have loved to have, you know, absolutely everybody on this card that made NXT what it is today. I would have had the Revival. I would have had all four members of Undisputed Era if I wanted to. But that's the thing about when you're having to book an NXT takeover, you have to make some tough decisions. So I did my best to incorporate at least half of the Undisputed Era on this card to begin with.
All I'm saying is, I don't think it's fair that I would lose a point, or I would be picked up on something that was never stated in rules beforehand. So the fact that I'm now getting picked up on,
I did say that it was, imagine it's a month.
You did not see that they need to be in the company to be on this card.
Imagine it's a once time from recording, and because of that, Revival, we have to assume, are probably going to be.
So do we base it on assumptions now? Do we just base it on assumptions now?
I'm basing it on the judging, and I think that
we're basing it on assumptions, though.
Ryan, your opening segment sounds like it belongs on an episode either of Monday Night Raw or to open a pay-per-view. Like, that segment puts too much focus on Triple H and Dustin Rhodes themselves. Triple H has a very selfless role when it comes to NXT. He puts the show and the talent ahead of everybody else, not just himself.
And he does that, Dave, and I disagree with you. That's one of the things I prefer about Ryan's show. I think Dustin coming over could be something they do, because it's the Dusty connection. That's something I actually find realistic. And I think it's a good utilization of Triple H, because he's taken the fall there to Dustin, and he's given Dusty his credit by doing that, and it's a very emotional and fitting moment to open the show. So I would give a heads up to Ryan for that. So really it comes down to your North American title matches and your women's tag team matches. Here's the thing. The North American title match, you have Riddle, you have Lee, you have Black, you have Nakamura, Neville, and Dallas for Ryan. For Dave, you have Priest, Corbin, Strong, Cruz, Dream, and Ricochet. It comes down to the winners there for me. And I would prefer to see Lee continue to dominate on the Raw brand. And I think that this win would do a lot of good for Damian Priest in retaining. So I prefer Dave for that. With the NXT Women's championship, the tag team championship, sorry. Shayna Baszler and Nia Jax versus Dakota Kai and Raquel Gonzalez. Like I said, going forward a month, Bayley and Sasha in the midst of this feud. It'll be after Hell in a Cell. Not saying it couldn't happen, but it's unlikely they'd win the titles back that quickly. I have to, again, give the points to Mr. David Haughney. And that is why, despite Ryan, a very good effort here, a very good attempt, but David Haughney ekes out the win today on Book It. So well done to Dave Haughney. Ryan, how do you feel about the result?
Starving, mate.
Love it. Haughney, did you feel that you had to debate and argue your way to that win there?
Hey, I was ready to hammer my points home. Like, that was a battle right there. Like, you know, Ryan called me out on a couple of things, but, you know, I was right back in it. And you know what? I, by no means was this a pushover. This was a fight. Like, this was me having to, you know, literally hammer home what it means to book a takeover.
And guys, it was a very, very, very close call here today again. But Dave, we've already seen Stephen Strachan advance on the other side of the bracket. Man, you could meet in the final, but the winner of the match between Jack Graham and Ross McLeod will be the man that you face in the next in the semi-final match. Who would you prefer to have in that one?
Honestly, I'd rather face Jack because he is my Saturday Draft Live co-host, and you know there's a ton of respect between me and him, so it would be good to go up against my co-host. But on the other side, I think Ross is actually very good at you know, putting a case forward, you know, debating his side of the argument. He's going to give Jack a run for his money, no doubt about it. So it wouldn't surprise me if Ross ended up in the semi-final either.
Dave, are you trying to say that Ross McLeod is an argumentative wee dick?
Yes, I am.
Well, what a way to end the show. Don't forget, check out everything else that's going on. You'll find Ryan Gallacher on this feed as well. As like I said, Pod 67 is out there. Go and check out or listen to that if you are a Celtic fan. And also David Haughney, the host of our very own Saturday Draft Live here. You can find them there every week. And guys, don't forget, check us out next time in the next match of the Book It Tournament. We'll see you later on. So, without further ado, the 10 minutes for Ryan Gallacher start now. They don't start yet.
I was going to eat that bad pizza so fucking quickly. But it was the driest bad I've ever had in my life. Hold on a minute.
Lovely. You get a chaser in. Oh, this is great. Choke on a piece.
Oh, fucking hell. It was like the driest. Mate, that was the driest bit of crust I've ever had in my life. But I just couldn't get rid of it, man.
Guys, I'm just saying this is going after the credits on this episode.
Okay, bye.